Next speaker. The gentleman that's been taking care of all the video, making sure that all of our fans out there in the world are seeing all of this awesome stuff. Maxim Sobolev. He's coming to us from Sippy Soft. He's also the author of RTP Proxy. Awesome. He's going to be talking to us about secure RTP support in RTP proxy, no?
Yeah, yeah.
I wasn't wrong. Okay, Max, take it away.
Oh, yeah, sorry. I have
hello everyone. As Alex said, my name is Maxim. I'm who out of you guys don't know this guy in picture?
That guy is my god.
Oh yeah. So I guess everyone here kind of asks this question or at some point of time, and everyone of you has a different probably answer or slightly different. For George it was plastics. I don't know, for me it's megantropy, which gets consumed by self-organizing structures. But in any case, we all kind of know more or less why we are here. So why I'm here? This picture here is, if you don't know, it's a place called Leontovich 10, L10, which is basically traffic exchange point in Ukraine. It's a pretty old picture, like circa 2003. And this is basically backbone of Ukrainian internet at the time. So all those cables essentially also different service providers living in those having offices there, and they basically interconnect like virus and all. And now that's sausage factory, I tell you. It's probably a little bit better 15 years after, but I mean, I got interested in telecommunications and open source pretty early. I got into open source in my university years. I learned about Unix, about FreeBSD in particular. Got experience with some other operating systems, HPUX and stuff. After I finished my education, I got Master of Science from Kiev University. The voice over IP kind of thing started growing, and it was to me it was pretty apparent at the time that it's going to be replacing like old style telecommunications, because there was no point, obviously, and we all know that. So, as I said, born and raised in USSR, people often ask me which country I'm originally from. What do I say? there is no such country anymore. Right now I live for the last 15 years in Canada, Vancouver, BC. As I said, I got a Master of Science in Physics and Radiophysics from Kyiv State University. In 2003, I joined Porta Software. Probably guys know because I'm still Zimmerman as Porta One these days. But yeah.
You were a baby.
So if that's Cisco ETA, for those guys who don't know. So that's it, my first experience with also voice over IP, and that's about the time we discovered SIP Express Router. We've been looking to build soft switch, and I started playing with it. It among all the projects at the time, it was most promising and most actively developed, I would say. Eventually, I spent 3 years with Porta Software. Then we kind of a little bit disagreed on open source strategy because really some companies still don't get it. At that time, it was even more difficult. Actually got a little bit of love battle going with them after my leaving them. There was like a little bit of misunderstanding of, but in any case, it got resolved. Well, it's it's known already. It apparently it's pretty kind of. There are rumors about it in Ukraine, at least in our community. So people know about it. It's not a big deal. Yeah, yeah. But anyway, so I left Porta and I founded my own company, SIP Software. And the thing that sets us apart with Porta in particular is that we really try to be a good citizen in open source world. Because I personally believe that open source is more of a source social contract type of thing. Open source is associated with innovations, and innovations are usually driven by people, not by organizations. In that sense, when we say, for example, free switch, we think of particular people, not of particular organization or asterisk or whatever. And that's what we kind of respect in our business model. From our perspective, our open source work is a toolbox. We're not trying to build like monolithic system. We work on particular tool which solves our need at the time. So it started with NetHelper. As I said, I started playing with the server pretty early. It did not have any not traversal functionality at the time, so we implemented that. And then it kind of overflowed towards pproxy because there are several scenarios where you cannot deal with NAT without pinning the media down. So we made RSP proxy. Then we created our own B2BA, which we needed to support our product and provide proper billing and stuff for customers. Then we did mod Python, which I think was the first foreign language module in Open SIPS or Chameleon, whatever. Then we did RTP cluster, which is still kind of experimental or work in progress. To this day, it basically helps us to load balance and manage multiple RTP proxies. And by multiple, I mean like tens of hardware pieces with like six RTP proxy on each. In the last few years, we've been doing a lot of work on continuous integration and making sure that our tools stay in good working order. Because as those projects kind of split and merge and whatnot, our client code gets kind of spread out. So right now we have all these different software maintained by different people talking to RTP proxy, for example. So we really need to take care of making sure that it all works. And we continue on B2B UA. So we now have a Go version, which has more performance. And we started work on Go version of RTP cluster, which will be probably available sometime soon. Now, on the open source team, we really don't have any problems with the forks. I mean, we consider all those projects in some sense our spiritual children or whatever. And if people take our ideas or take our code and build something different out of it, it's cool with us. And then on the what might be sets RTP proxy apart from some other projects in this area is that we really take no shortcuts on reliability. We usually when you're talking to software or any other kind of engineers, there's always trade-offs when you build your systems. So you cannot have like all at the same time. So between like reliability, functionality, and performance, we pick reliability as our first priority. Then functionality is kind of secondary, and the performance is kind of on the background. Because when you start trying to get to the best performance available, you'll have to cut the corners. So you'll have to go through the layers of OSI. And that will make your software more less generic and more pinned down to particular way of doing things. We also quite picky on our licensing. All of our code is BSD licensed and puts a little bit of challenges. Because we cannot take all the code that we would like probably to take in our projects and use it. GPL3 in my particular view is a particular disaster because all GPL comes from the era when proprietary software was kind of, everybody was thinking Windows is going to win everybody and everybody is going to use Windows eventually in commercial software. But as we know, it never happened. And these days, less strings you have on your license is better for, at least in our view. And then as I said, continuous integration is quite important. It's a canon war of worms, obviously. But the point is that sometimes you need the worms. For example, if you go fishing, in this case, if you're trying to catch bugs, you also need to deal with the worms. It takes quite a lot of time to get things up and running. But then at the end of the day, you'll get not only bugs fixed, but also if you use code coverage, you can also see which code might be obsolete or which code could be optimized by just looking at your coverage report. There was quite a lot of work now that we have all this Python code and different modules to port over to Python 3.6, but it's all been done, and I think we'll over to 3.6 now. And then the last thing that we added in last year, we added modules support, and I've already been speaking to some of the people here. We got some more ideas, so hopefully we'll get more implemented next year. And basically, this is pretty much the last piece that had been keeping us from implementing something like secure RTCP. Well, not the last, but one of the last. The another part that we really want to get implemented is as we expand the protocol. One problem is particularly difficult to solve is that we either need to make it very complicated, so we need to support all those additional parameters, or we need, if we don't want to do that and just want to have simple functions, we will have to increase the latency. This was a problem with some of the patches that OpenSIP's team has proposed to set the timeouts for the sessions. So what we have in mind with that is we would like to have more or less Turing complete language that you can put into your RTP proxy request, and then you can build your essentially logic with that. So instead of implementing complex protocol with a lot of options, we would like to have try at least to implement multiple simple functions that you can then string together and pack it as send us as a single request and get RTP proxy to process it and return in one round trip. And that's pretty much the next step, I think, that that will take to get to the secure RTP support and all that good stuff. And last but not least, would like to thank everybody, like organizers, for organizing this event. We want to thanks to our patrons, Voice Center, Suzanne, Flavia, Danielle, CP Software customers, there's too many of them, unfortunately, but we have several over the years here. We have Vasilios, and then Telnix is a long customer. I think that's the way they discovered actually OpenSIP probably by using our products. Government of Canada does a lot of good job. We use some of the government programs that support research and development. And yeah, it works pretty well. And yeah, that's the contacts. And if you have any questions, I can answer them.
First of all, let's give this guy a round of applause. Okay, do we have some questions for Max? All right away.
Is currently the your Git is currently supported for the RTP proxy? Because I had a case when I tried to pull the master version of the RTP proxy, it was like months ago, and I found out that the version was called like alpha dirty version of what was said. I mean that, can I rely on this or not, or have I found some kind of the forum where I can find what the version is stable and how I'm able to understand which version is stable? Because as far as I understand, I have to rely on the master bridge first of all.
Yeah, this is kind of
and then I just decided that I have to roll back, actually.
Well, the thing is that we pretty much use it from master anyways in our environment. So it's a little bit of lack of release management and stuff. But it,
so
it
which
just
resource or reference can be used to find this table and the last support?
Last table, I think 2.1, there is a branch 2.1. So that's the latest table at the moment. As I said, we want to release pretty soon. I was hoping to do it before summit, but I got all the mixed up with the preparations. So I'll probably release it and post it in a week or two after the OpenSIP summit, because we just finished a lot bunch of work on continuous integration and coverage reports, and that brought a lot of issues that we fixed, so it makes sense to get it released.
Any other questions?
No other questions, huh? Okay, one more round of applause for Max. Thank you.